I like to speak from Luke chapter 14. If you have your Bibles, please open up to Luke chapter 14. I'll be speaking about the parable of the great feast. Say here when you're here. Good. Parable of the great feast. I'm going to start in verse 15. I'll be going to verse 24. Hearing this, a man sitting at the table with Jesus exclaimed, "What a blessing it is that we will be able to attend a banquet in the kingdom of God." And Jesus replied with this story. A man prepared a great feast and sent out many invitations. And when the banquet was ready, he sent his servant to tell the guests, "Come, the banquet is ready." But they all began to make excuses. One said, "I have just bought a field and must inspect it. Please excuse me." And another said, "I have just bought 5 pairs of oxen and I want to try them out. Please excuse me." Another said, "I just got married, so I can't come." The servant returned and told his master what they had said. And his master was furious and said, "Go quickly into the streets and alleys of the town. Invite the poor, the crippled, the blind, the lame." After the servant had done this, he reported, "There is still room for more." So his master said, "Go out into the country lanes behind the hedges and urge anyone you find to come so that the house will be full. For none of those I first invited will get even the smallest taste of my banquet." Amen. Since I'm speaking and reflecting on mission work tonight, I felt like this was obtainable for us as a church. I believe what the Lord has in store for us tonight is a call to action. I have 3 points I want to go over. I'm going to make it very quick and very simple, and I want to make it very practical. Because as we leave here, I want us to be able to apply it to our daily lives. My first point is this, is that recognize that you are on a mission. In verse 17, it says, the master sent his servant to tell the guests. So each and every one of us here are being sent by the Lord. Each and every one of us here must recognize that we are on a mission. This servant recognized his identity and he went to meet the people. Not just that he went to meet the people, but he went to meet them where they were at. He went to meet them where they were located. We need to be open to any and all guests, and everyone is invited to this banquet. I can go as far as saying that even in this church, we need to invite everyone. The person can smell bad, he can look bad, he can dress poorly, but we must accept them. As sad as it is, it's easier for us to go to mission work than to bring the mission into the church. And I don't say that as condemnation, I say it as something that I'm putting practical in my life because there's conviction in that for me, that I need to work harder at preaching the gospel and inviting people to come into our home here in Anaheim, California. I don't necessarily need to run to Africa or to Mexico in order to do the Lord's work. I have work right here to do. That's what we need to do. We need to take that question to consideration. If the people that I just showed you on this screen, if the people that we're talking about that we're serving, we're helping build homes for these people, what if these people were at our door? What if a group of 30 or 40 of them were at the door and said, "Hey, I want to come in"? They might be black, might be Mexican, they might be Asian. Would we be comfortable? Would we, Emmanuel, be ready as a church to say, "Hey, come take a seat next to me. You might smell pretty bad, but I'm going to have you sit next to me and I'm going to love you"? It's a call to action. It's not about what we feel. It's about what's written. And the word is written that he says, go and tell everyone, those who are blind, those who are poor. So it doesn't matter whether that person smells or looks funny or acts differently. Our goal and our job as Christians is to put them next to us and say, "I'm going to show you that same love that Christ showed." My second point is this, what is my mission? What is your mission? In verse 21, he says, go quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and invite the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. We must understand that God called us to serve in our local community. Anaheim, California has so much struggle and so much pain already. Where are you called to serve? And if God can trust me here in my city, if God can trust you in Anaheim, he'll be able to trust you in Africa. What are you doing in your city? Be faithful with what God has given you. Luke 16:10 says that if you are faithful in the little things, you will be faithful in the large ones. But if you are dishonest in little things, you won't be honest with greater responsibilities. You might even been asking, who am I? Who am I that God will want to use me? What makes me qualified to go preach the gospel? What makes me qualified to go out and tell people about Christ? 2 Corinthians 3:5-6. It is not that we think we are qualified to do anything on our own. Our qualification comes from God. He has enabled us to be ministers of his new covenant, a covenant not written of law, but of the Spirit. The old is gone. Behold, the new comes in. The Spirit gives life. I want to give an example of that. This past Christmas, we did some caroling, and I'm so proud of our local churches here. Bethel Church organized a caroling event at a hospital on Christmas Day. And though I wasn't able to attend, a lot of our people went to that. And we got to go into our community to serve rather than sleeping in, rather than being with our families right in the morning. I'm speaking to myself because I'm convicted for sleeping in, right? But they went out and they served and they did something in our own community. How many people in our own community need help? How many people are struggling in our own community? How many places can we go and serve? There are homeless shelters, there's streets, there's abortion clinics, there's hospitals and orphanages, programs for underprivileged kids or children or adults with mental disabilities. There are places for us to serve in our community. There are places for us to go out. It's not rather just us, let's be here and be comfortable. What can I do to be uncomfortable for Christ? What can I do to get out of my zone, my comfort, to go serve the people around me? Because I'll tell you, church, that we're going to be accountable for Anaheim, California. We will be accountable for this area. The Lord will ask us what we did with Loera High School. And I'm being real. There's a school right across the street and people are suffering, they're dying, they're committing suicide, they're going through sexual immorality, they're overdosing. What are we doing as a church to fill it? To fill this place with people who need God. To fill this place and bring people in. We need to serve. And for the youth, I have a message directly for you. You don't need your church to change in order for you to change. Be the change that you want to be. You might be saying, well, I'm not comfortable. Still half the service is in Romanian. Don't follow that. Follow what God puts in your heart and say, I'm still going to be committed to this church regardless. Regardless of how the program looks like. Say, God, I'm ready to serve and be ready to be weird for the gospel. Be ready to bring people in when no one else wants to bring people in. Be ready to invite them to sit next to you when no one else will sit next to them. And take advantage of Resurrection Youth Nights. Our Friday nights are amazing, and I love them. But guys, for real, like, understand how privileged we are as a church for what we have. I've been to many Romanian churches and many local churches, and I'm not saying this to bash on anyone because I love them all, but we are so fortunate for what we have. You have the music you want. You have the messages that are catering to you. You have food. You have games. You have lights. Everything is catered for you to grow. Take advantage of it. Bring your friends in. Don't wait for someone else. Invite those people from school. Invite your colleagues from work. And it's not your duty to say, well, what if they don't grow? Well, what if they don't understand? It's like what Paul says, I plant the seed in Apollos' waters, but Christ brings the increase. It's not me. I just have to be faithful with what God has given me. And if we continue to act like that and continue to stir up that passion, like, hey, God gave me a place to serve and to bring people in. Once that place is full, then we'll worry about this. Once that place is overpacked and we can't take it anymore, then we'll bring the people in here. Let us work with what's been given to us. Let us be faithful with what God has entrusted unto us. There is so much opportunity that we got to take advantage of. Our church is a blessing. It's not just Resurrection Youth. Our church is a blessing, man. Like every time I go out of state or somewhere and I'm serving or I'm visiting another church, the thing I think about the most is saying, man, I can't wait to get back home because I love my church. I'm not saying this in any disrespect, but I can come in jeans. I can dance, I can sing, I can jump, I can cry, and it's all good because I'm in a place that caters the Holy Spirit. I'm in a place that's open and receptive to God moving in this place, and I understand that I am privileged to be where I'm at. So you, church, take advantage of what we have. Don't neglect that God has given us a place of free worship. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, and there's freedom in this place when God moves. I am so fortunate to be here. I'm so fortunate to be part of this church. And my last point, have I done all that I can do to fill this banquet? Verse 22 says, after the servant had done this, he reported, there is still room for more. Verse 23, he said, so his master said, go out into the country lanes behind the hedges, urge anyone you find to come so that the house will be full. Although this parable, Jesus is referring to the kingdom of God, this passage is also referring to Emmanuel Church. It's speaking directly to our church. This is the house of God. This is a place of healing. This is a place of restoration and anointing. This is where last week our elders anointed those who were sick with oil. This is where we practice laying on of hands. This is a place where total and complete transformation can happen. We must not undermine the church. We have such an amazing church, and we have such an amazing banquet here to meet up together. We must believe that this temple caters to the Holy Spirit. And as we meet here, his presence comes and gives us life. We need a fresh outpouring. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 17 says, for the Lord is a spirit, and wherever the spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Verse 18, so all of us who have had this veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like him as we are changed into his glorious image. Are we being able to show and reflect the glory of God where we are here right now in this church? When people see us, can they say, I see a reflection of God in that person? Can people say that I see Christ and his attributes in that person? Are there people being set free when they're in this church? I believe Frate Lazagog spoke a couple weeks back, and he said, how many of us at one point or another last year, God helped us to get out of some type of car accident that could have been fatal? You guys remember that? Almost the whole church raised their hand. I personally have been delivered here. I know many people have personally been touched and transformed in this place. And the reason that some of these seats are even occupied tonight are because God's presence has been on them and transformed them in this place. We need to cater the Holy Spirit in this place. We need to make it a place receptive to the Holy Spirit to come and move. If our Romanian brothers and sisters do not want to join the banquet, if they choose to not attend church and fellowship with us in this place, if they choose to not come to the house of the Lord, rather than waiting, like verse 21, we must honor our master and go quickly. Please don't take me out of context. Keep praying for your loved ones. Keep praying for your Romanian culture. Keep praying for your country. Keep praying for these people. But remember that God wants us to go and get the other ones in. Let us remember that we have to go invite everyone, not just those who are comfortable with us. 2 Timothy 2:25 says, gently instruct those who oppose the truth. Perhaps God will change these people's hearts and they will learn the truth. Keep correcting those in your life. Keep preaching to those Romanians next to you, but don't neglect bringing in others. Don't let that hold you back for one second. And this place becomes a multicultural, multilingual melting pot, praise the Lord. Because that's what the word says. That's what the word, I'm preaching from the word, not my own doctrine, not what I know. I'm preaching what I read. I love our Romanian brothers and sisters too. But you know what this is going to do? If we go and we reach out to others, if we reach out to other cultures, if we reach out to other languages, other people, what this is gonna do is like what Paul says, it's gonna inspire a jealousy in the Romanian community. This is gonna inspire a jealousy in your fathers and your mothers who don't know Christ, your sons and your daughters. Maybe you fathers and mothers, maybe you're here alone tonight saying, I wish my kid was with me. Well, why don't we inspire them by bringing others in? Why don't we fill this place so much that when they see how packed it is with other cultures, they will say, I so want to be part of that. And I know that I will be accepted and I can come as I am. We must plant the seeds. We must plant the seeds into our community. And just to give you a personal reference, to be intimate with you, part of my testimony, I was baptized in the Holy Spirit in 2010 here. I was filled with the Holy Spirit. I was baptized in water. I walked astray from the Lord. But as I walked astray, someone in this church bombarded me with texts, calls, invites, telling me to come be a part of it, telling me to be part of this place. Maybe the seed didn't activate right away, but over time, as it was watered, it began to grow. And years down the road, when I said, God, I've had enough. I want you. I don't know where to start. Where do I go? I remembered that person. I gave him a call and I said, what's going on? And they couldn't stop screaming. But that's the way it is. Sometimes you might not see things that happen right away. You might not see progression right away. But as we invest, that investment will grow. The word says that nothing we do for the Lord goes void. Nothing that we do for the Lord will be put aside. God honors everything that we do for him. So Romans 11:11, it says, did God's people stumble and fall beyond recovery? Of course not. They were disobedient. So God made salvation available to the Gentiles because he wanted the people to become jealous and claim it for themselves. Let's make our Romanian community jealous. Let's make our brothers and sisters jealous. Let this place be weird for the Lord. Let us bring people in. Let us bring cultures in. Let's sit with them. Let's welcome them. Let us go out of our way to shake their hand. Let's go out of our way to buy them a meal. Let's go out of our way to sit next to them instead of our children or our wives or our friends. Let us not bypass right them, but let us sit next to them and talk to them about the Lord. 2 Corinthians 5:15, I'm gonna close out with this. He died for everyone so that those who receive his new life will no longer live for themselves. Instead, they will live for Christ who died and was raised for them. We have stopped evaluating others from a human point of view. And at one time, we thought of Christ merely from a human perspective. How differently we know him now. This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone, a new life has begun. In conclusion, we must open the door to every tongue, to every nationality, to every ethnicity, to every race, to every culture. Let people see us as true Christians, followers of Christ, followers of the word. Not on culture, not on tradition, but what the Lord has preached and told us to do. Just like the Pharisees always questioned him and asked him, this man is not from God. Jesus was speaking from the Lord. Let people see this place in such a way that it will bring zeal and jealousy over them to fill this place. But what we must do is do our part as Christians, as brothers and sisters. We must serve in our community. We must serve in the people next to us. We must invite those people next to us, but not merely to invite. We must sit with them. We must speak to them, encourage them, bless them. And this is my call to action for the church. I want to leave you with the call to action. Let us meet someone right where they're at and be the mission for them. What that means is if they're in the streets, that means we go to the streets. If they're in the clubs, let's go pick them up. Maybe not in the club, but let's go pick them up. But let's go and meet the people where they're at. I was speaking to someone today and he gave me great advice. He said that the servant went out and met them where they were. The master sent a servant to meet them where they were. Can we go and meet the people where they are? Can you go to your schools? Can you go to your workplace and meet the person right there where they're at that office space? Andrew, while you're working on cars, can you talk to the guy next to you? Andrew, while you're at school and you're learning things, can you minister to someone by just showing love? There's so many opportunities for us to serve the Lord. Let us open our eyes and be receptive to what God is speaking to us because the Holy Spirit wants to work through us. Let us all invite one person next Sunday night. Preach. Let us all invite one person Sunday night. And even if they don't come, you know what happens? That seed is planted. And you invite them again, that seed's planted. And one day when they've had enough of this world, like the Bible says, like the prodigal son in Luke 15 says, when he came to his senses, he finally came to it. It's like that. When they finally come to their senses, they're gonna know where to go. That was my biggest struggle. I had no idea where to go once I wanted Christ, when Christ wanted me. Let's invite one person. Let's fill this place up. Let's fill these empty seats right here. Let's fill up this place with people that are in our schools and in our job places. And let's not worry about what the program looks like. Youth, don't worry if there's 15 or 20 minutes, 30 minutes in Romanian. Bring them here and let's minister to them. Let them see us being different. Let us show the change that we want to be, like we said earlier. Let's be the example for them to follow. And once they see it, they're like, these guys are real. This is real church. This is what I've been missing. I'm sick of going to program after program, hour by hour. I want to see the truth revealed. I want to see people living out what they read. I want to see people actually reading and living it out. So if you bow your heads, I'd just like to close this in prayer. Father God, you are supreme above all. We honor you and we thank you, Lord, that your spirit dwells in this place. We repent, Father God, of our actions. I repent of my actions, Lord. Whether I have been listening to you or not, God, I repent now and I say, Lord, help me be different. Help me be the example in Anaheim, California. Help me be the example in my community. Help our church turn from its wicked ways and you will hear our cries. And as we fast and pray, Lord, your word says that if we fast and seek you, you will hear us when we cry out. Fill this place, God, but use us to fill it. Let us not just keep saying fill it. Let us be partakers in filling it. And I want to be the first to say that, God. Put me to work. Put this youth to work. Put the generation of elders to work. Put the grandparents to work. They're not done yet. We're here to work together and fill this place for the glory of your name. And God, we leave Africa and Mexico in your hands, Lord. And we know that you will provide all things, God. Because everything that's according to your will, God, is your bill. And I thank you for that, Father God. That as you send us, we know you're with us. We bless you, we honor you, and we love you. Amen.